Government press releases do not tell you the truth. They're designed to create distraction. When you see something before your eyes, you know that's real. When you see this hand in front of my face, you know that's real. I know I have five fingers. A government press release in Ireland in 2013, and has been for a long time, has been telling us we have six fingers.
What it means to be Irish in 2013. We are people who are the ghosts which haunt themselves.
This is why there's no popular uprising in Ireland. Because the establishment owns the people who should be storming the barricades.
My name is Thomas Sheridan. I'm an author, artist, public speaker, amongst other things. I write books on pathology and psychopathology. I'm very interested in relationships. I'm very interested in how concepts relate to each other and how people and situations and systems perceive each other. Not just interpersonal relationships, relationships between people, citizens, and their country, and how they perceive themselves within their own reality. And I've come to the conclusion that in 2013, the people of Ireland are in a dysfunctional relationship with their own society, and it's time to grow up and have an adult conversation. Because we have been led into the abyss, a financial abyss, of 67 billion euros of debt that is not ours. This is private debt which belongs to the international bankers. This has been foisted upon us. It's not our money. We're actually paying for someone else's incompetence, corruption, and dysfunctionality. And it's no different than when somebody... See, people in Ireland, we're aware that something is wrong, but we cannot articulate it because our opinions and our perceptions are given to us by government-appointed experts. A government press release is not reality. A government press release could tell you that I'm standing in the middle of a desert rather than standing in Galway Bay on a breezy day. And people have this ability to switch off that perception of reality, and what they do is they start believing these government press releases. The time is to stop doing that. The time is to realize we have a dysfunctional relationship with our own perception of us as a people and this society, and it's time for a grown-up conversation, and that's the purpose of this film.
Thank you. That's all, folks.
Irishness, right? Now I know this is not, you know, we're talking about Ireland here, but like, you know, we are Irish, we are different, we have a different culture. This is why we produce, like, you know, this surrealist kind of life culture. You know, there's a reason for that. This is a gift. This is when Spike Milligan, who was of Irish descent, his father was from Sligo, when he was making those comedies about the Irish back in the 80s, what he was really saying was the opposite of what people were thinking. He was showing that the Irish do have a kind of a logic that's very good at subverting the system. And one of those things is that, like, things like our approach to time. I remember, like, Dave Allen saying that he was in a train station in Dublin, and some foreign tourist said, "I don't know why you bother having timetables, the trains are always late." And a guy turned around and said, "But we didn't have timetables, we wouldn't know how late the trains were." And it's logic, that's an Irish logic. And one of the things, and this is an important one for getting out of television thing, when you're away from television, you're less time bound. You're less bound to the clock. And you look at, this is one of the things they're trying to do to us as Irish people, they're trying to make us efficient, time bound Europeans. We're not, we're different, we're Irish. We're a different kind of people. And that's okay, that's something better. I'm not saying, you know, I'm not one of these people that thinks the Irish are special or anything like that, but this is just how we are. This is our idiosyncratic cultural nature. If we're not time bound to time, we're less bound to control bureaucracies and structures. And this is why things like switching off the TV is a great way to start doing that, because you're no longer bound to the time, the continuum, and the measurement within the TV schedule. And it's funny that, like, you know, that's an aspect of our Irishness that would be very useful, because that used to drive people mad. You know, like when the British ran this country, they were constantly, the British rule, one of the reasons they brought down the British rule in Ireland was not just because of force of arms, because the British couldn't administer the country, because we were unadministrable. We would not show up on time, we would not go to court when we needed to. This is how we were. And you look at the, you know, shows like the Irish, you know, books like the Irish RM, which was made into a TV show in the 80s, that are all about a British magistrate who cannot control the Irish because they're just too eccentric. And in the end, rather than hating them, he comes to realise that it's good for him because it's allowed him to enjoy his life better.
I'm standing outside Lynch's Castle here. This is in Galway City on the west coast of Ireland. Behind me is this building from the medieval period called Lynch's Castle, because it belonged to a very powerful family of that name. It may also be the place where the term lynch mob derived from, but that's not known for certain. But whatever, the once occupant of this town, this building, hung his own son after he murdered a Spanish merchant due to an outcry of the citizens of the city, who were very fond of this Spanish merchant. Lynch took his own son and hung him off the top of this gargoyle encrusted building in order to placate the locals and soothe their anger over what the son had done. Today, this building is the headquarters in the city for Allied Irish banks. Have we moved forward? I'll let you decide.
You know, in Ireland, where's the voice of dissent? Where's the opposition to all this, right? The opposition in Ireland were bought off the unions I'm talking about. In Ireland, the unions are predominantly public sector unions. They're, you know, the semi-state companies, the railways, the electrical companies, the phone companies, and they're also the administrative classes, the civil servants, public sector workers. During the 1990s and through the 2000s, they were bought off as something called partnership. Partnership was a deal created between the government at the time, the Fianna Fáil party, and the public sector unions predominantly. So it was like a plea bargaining thing that they would pay them for not going on strike. We used to have quite an active trade union, you know, system in Ireland at one time. It was predominantly, it really was a trade union. It was probably working class people who worked in factories and things like that. So it was basically an extortion racket. It was basically a protection racket. Don't go on strike and they'll pay you. And what happened then, public sector workers, despite having all the advantages that private sector workers don't have, like jobs for life, incredible amount of holidays, fully paid up pensions, were then paid competitive rates the same as the private sector. So if you were a manager in an administrative department within, say, a bank, and your salary was 70,000, 80,000 euros a year, a civil servant working 30 hours a week with vast amounts of holidays and a big pension was paid the same. Now, for a long time, but nobody cared. But did an agenda start to reveal itself? What was happening here was the Irish government. They were creating an Orwellian inner party to create a buffer between the private sector, the unemployed, and the government and the business classes. So what happens is in Ireland, the people who should be down at government buildings protesting the most, storming the barricades literally at this stage, you know, looking for the bankers to be arrested, are actually the bulldogs of the establishment, because they're still being paid off. So we've created an Orwellian class here, an inner party, and their job is to stop the working classes and the private sector middle classes from actually having any power in this country. One of the leaders of the biggest unions here has been a director of the central bank since 1996. So a trade union leader, a guy who calls himself a socialist in this country, probably the most famous figure within the union movement here, is also a banker. So the whole thing is geared towards any kind of popular protest. In fact, when they have any kinds of protests against the austerity measures or the taxation, these state-sanctioned Orwellian inner party members of the public sector and civil service unions, what they actually do is they are given a protest. It's theirs. They have ownership over it. So when they march, you don't see the real protesters. They're actually hidden at the back. And it's a deal between the unions to only have the public sector unions and those types on camera with the main TV companies. The real protesters, the ones who are genuinely hurting and genuinely angry, they're hidden at the back of these marches and ignored. This is why there's no popular uprising in Ireland, because the establishment owns the people who should be storming the barricades.
One of the main methods of control in Ireland, in the Republic of Ireland, well, the former Republic of Ireland, is the idea of the parish pump. A lot of this is rooted in kind of a GAA county colours mindset. I've even seen this going on with the so-called, you know, protest movement of recent times. They will march, you know, you see the videos on YouTube of, like, you know, four or five souls marching through some town in West Cork. And they're always in their county colours when they're ever trying to evict somebody from somewhere. They're always in the county colours. You never ever see an Irish flag, or rarely see a tricolour. This plays perfectly into the control system. They want people not seeing issues like the household tax, as national problems or national issues, which they are. These affect all of us. It doesn't affect people in Cork, Kerry, Dublin, Mayo, Donegal. It affects this nation. And they've successfully and almost beautifully, in a devious sense, used this whole loyalty to your GAA county colours to distract from your notion of being a citizen. The vast majority of Irish people today see themselves as citizens of their GAA county colours and not citizens of Ireland. This is very, very useful for national policies to be put through. This is an imposed myopia placed upon the people. A really devious sleight of hand that's been played. You're a citizen of Ireland. You're not a citizen of your local county colours. About 10 years ago, I was giving a presentation in government buildings regarding a transport issue, and we were informed inside the building, upon meeting the politicians, that the politicians had parliamentary privilege, but we as visitors did not, even though it took place inside a government chamber. What we were essentially being told was, that politicians inside government buildings have freedom of speech, but we as citizens voicing our concerns on issues did not have freedom of speech.
People assume that, like, you know, hard economic times are always negative. They're always like horrors. They're horrors because the ruling class sees them that way, the bankers, the media, because they have no fallback plan. But if you look at how culture flourishes during hard times, I mean, Ireland, I mean, this country is a cultural machine. I mean, incredible for population, the amount of artists, writers, musicians, you know, everything that we produced in the arts, and they all came out of hard times. You know, I was a kid back in the 80s, and I mean, yeah, there was nothing to do. It was, you know, you're especially working class like I was, and, you know, grew up in the ghetto, there was nothing. But there was music, and there was comedy, and there was art. People had, like, and that flourished in Ireland. I mean, so many people who started out arts movements in Ireland in the 80s went on to become Hollywood directors, some of the biggest bands in the world. You know, and that came out of this desire to create when there was nothing materialistic in the way. So let's not assume that this austerity, which is a fancy way of saying poverty, is what it is. Suffrage and pain and agony. It provides opportunities for culture and creativity, and we should never lose sight of that. You know, that's a wonderful thing. That's actually a way out in many ways. Because that actually would, you know, young people say, well, you know, like, I can't look forward to a sort of a traditional economic future. Well, maybe I can become a musician or an artist or, you know, a graffiti artist and then become a proper artist in the galleries and make a living from it. Poetry, you name it, it's all there to play for. You know, Nietzsche said, what doesn't kill me makes me stronger. When Nietzsche talked about the Übermensch, you know, the superior man, that was co-opted by the Nazis through his sister after he died, who completely reinterpreted his work to make it seem he was talking about German nationalism and racial superiority. He was not at all. He was talking about the Übermensch as the superior human being who transcended his hardships, transcended the limitations of his life. See, all our experiences are posed by culture and economics even, to create a sort of a human being that was away from, you know, outside the control system. The Übermensch, the Superman, that's what the real Superman is, one who doesn't depend on the control system, on the culture, on the class, to create identity for himself or herself. And that's very important, because when you have nothing, let's talk about this, when you have nothing, what you have is a blank canvas. When you have nothing, you have a blank slate. So you can then begin to actually develop yourself according to what you want, rather than fulfilling socio-economic roles. This is powerful and very deep stuff that people need to consider. You know, they shouldn't be all like, okay, we're heading towards like 20 years of poverty. That doesn't mean 20 years of, you know, of you living a stupid life. Or you watching television for 20 years, sitting at home all day. You're unemployed. You don't sit at home watching, you know, soap operas all day, or cooking, bloody cooking shows, you know. What you do is you take that time and you create. And you teach your children to create, and you teach your friends to create. You do things, you build a new reality. And that's an advantage that comes from austerity. So, you know, the media wants you down, because they want you watching the cooking shows in the afternoon on their television. They want you out there doing things. They don't want you gardening, they want you watching Gardener's World. You know, so it's a substitute. It's really porn, that's really what it is. It's social pornography. Instead of having, you know, it's not sexual pornography, it's social pornography. You're watching role models doing on TV what you should be doing. That's why people watch soap operas as well. That is a really big one that people should take from that, because one thing Nietzsche said, and it's such a beautiful thing when you think about it, he said, if I could wish something on my friends, my dearest friends, it would be a miserable life, because then they would know the value of living. And so that's, you know, maybe now we're going to learn the value of living, finally. We had 15 years of economic prosperity in the Celtic Tiger, and what did we produce? Boy bands.
here I am in John F. Kennedy Park, in the middle of Galway City, a park named after Kennedy when he made a visit here, not long before he was assassinated in a conspiracy. And yet if you mention conspiracy to people today, they think it isn't real. They think it isn't real because they've been conditioned to believe ridiculous conspiracies about aliens and monsters and all kinds of nonsense that's distracted from the reality that there is a real conspiracy that happens every day. It happens in corporations, it happens in big business, it happens in economics, it happens in finance, it happens in governments. It's not necessarily cloak and dagger stuff. It's definitely not glamorous. It's definitely not like Mr. Burns in The Simpsons. These are cartoon allegories of the idea of conspiracy. What a conspiracy is powerful people conspiring to get more money, more power, and more influence. This is the history of Western civilization. This is what conspiracy is. It is not an esoteric, far out, unbelievable fantasy. It's a reality. It's what the Western society was built on. We have to understand these things. We can't be sitting there saying, oh, conspiracy doesn't actually happen. Of course conspiracy happens. It's the whole history of Western society. And when people start saying, oh, conspiracy theorist, they're trying to distract from you. They're trying to remove from your opinions and your questions. Remember, your criticism, your cynicism is the most valuable thing you have. And that's a conspiracy too.
This household tax and all these plethora of new taxes they're bringing in, they're not to pay for public services, they're to keep bank officials and politicians out of jail. I've no doubt that most Irish people would have no problem at all paying extra taxes if these taxes were actually going to improve the quality of life and the standard of living in terms of public services delivered to the people here. That's not what they're being used for. These taxes are being used so the people who caused the collapse are not held responsible. The TV license is an absolute abomination, and it was brought to the fore with a high profile death from an overdose of cocaine by a famous RT presenter. This was an insight into the culture and the mindset within our National Propaganda Service, RTE. And in fact, it's probably pretty typical of the mainstream media in general in this country. But what made this particular instance so sickening, and I'm not putting down the man who died, and I don't mean any disrespect to his family, because cocaine is a horrific addiction for someone to have, but it was being paid through public funding. And that's just the end of it. And this is why they stop referring to it as a TV license, and they want to bring in some kind of a broadcasting tax instead. This is very psychopathic. You just change the terms of reference so you forget the injustices that were created by the old system. So the cocaine and champagne lifestyles of the Horty so-called stars was paid for with the old TV license, but that won't be applicable if they change it to a broadcasting tax or service or whatever. It's very sneaky. What also makes RTE so obnoxious, apart from the fact that it just simply is a press office for the government and its plans and agendas, is that it pays its so-called stars enormous salaries. And if you look at their viewership in global terms, RTE has no bigger an audience than a cable access operator would have in Ohio or Alabama. Yet they get paid them salaries that are comparable to BBC and even American mainstream networks. This is delusions of grandeur fed by a narcissistic supply from the government in the form of our taxes. We're actually being taxed to pay for the propaganda that we're being handed. One of the most devious tricks played on the Irish population by the cabal of the coagulated politicians and journalists, mass media, is how they have coached the Irish people to call elected representatives by their first name, Charlie, Bertie, Enda, etc. This is quite unique in to Ireland. It goes on nowhere else. These people are not our friends. We should not be calling them by their first names. They are the friends of the Irish propaganda networks and journalism, and the cozy relationship between journalists, TV reporters within the government buildings and the various restaurants and bars around government buildings is reflected in how we're given their first names to call them by. No, it's the politicians who are friends with the journalists. We are not friends with the journalists. So we have to stop this in this country. We have to stop referring to these politicians by their first names. Charlie Haughey lived like a Renaissance prince, enjoying a lifestyle of corruption. He wasn't a man of the people, and he was never our Charlie.
Totally against the idea of a violent revolution. I don't believe in those things because they have a history of failure. They always do. They always will. Because what happens is when the winning party, there's always a division after the revolution happens, and you have divisions of factions. It happens in every revolution. They always lead in bloodbaths, and they always end up in oppression and totalitarianism. They don't work. Another thing too is that you have to remember that if there's a policeman or a soldier on the other side of that barricade, that's another human being just like you. That's another person. He's a representative of the oppression, but he's not your oppressor. So you should not be picking on him or her wearing that uniform. They're not your enemy. They're just someone, they're another human being like you. But again, the psychopathic system is always about divide and conquer. It's always about dehumanizing. You put someone in a uniform, right? You're suddenly, and they themselves also come to believe they've been dehumanized at some level. They're now separate from the society. But they're really not looking at, he's not representing himself or you, and you're not really representing yourself for the state. What has happened is the control system has given two mirrors, and the two mirrors are facing each other, and we don't see what's going on behind the back of the mirrors. Our enemies are not the police, they're not the army, they're not even the politicians as such. This is a game that where everything has sort of become like this. The actual enemy is the pathological system behind it. And there's no way of reforming that. Voting will never work. Protesting will never work. The way you reform it is to get away from it. And what, if I was to say, the ultimate revolution would be, as I said, evolution. And how does that happen? Well, we're all waking up now. The world is changing rapidly. We're all changing as people. Instead of going back to the old Civil War politics or going back to the system and saying we can reform the system by voting these bastards out. No. Become distance. Like I said earlier on, people have their own skills and their own trades and their own networks of people. You then have an emerging culture, a new culture. And this culture, you have to use that emerging culture, not just in Ireland, but all over the world, of what we call the woken up people, to evolve away from the mainstream society. And when that happens, we kill the mainstream society. We make it irrelevant. And you'll be amazed how quickly that will vanish. There is a lot of truth to the thing that if you put your focus on something, carrying someone else's problems around with you, that it stops you from evolving. It's like I went to see the play years ago, Checkmates on Broadway with Denzel Washington, before he was famous. It was a great line. The play was about this African-American elderly couple who came from the civil rights era in the 60s, and they were renting an apartment to a wealthy African-American yuppie, spoiled couple, who were making big money in the basement, in the lower part of the house. And the old guy was very happy and contented with his life, and the young guy was very angry, and he thought the white man was getting him for everything. And the old guy grabs him to one side and he says, "You have opportunities and a lifestyle that I never had when I was a kid. And what are you doing? You're blaming the white man. You're running around." He says, "You're like a dog that's been tied to a post. And then somebody takes the post away, but you're still running around. You don't know the opportunities you have now compared to my generation, even though it's not perfect." And that's what happens to us. We think that's the same thing. this, well, we have to form a political party and take the system down through voting. No, that's the dog running around the polls but taken away. The dog has to leave. It's like right back to the thing getting off the chessboard. And I really do believe that we are, I'm not talking about kind of a new wave or consciousness kind of thing, although I do kind of believe in the consciousness, there is a lot of truth to that. That if we evolve, we don't take our problems with us.
One of the things I find remarkable, if not comical, is that the same expert economists and pundits who've been wheeled out since the 1980s and who are directly responsible for much of the ridiculous advice that led towards the economic crash in Ireland are still on TV, they're still in the papers, they're still being hired as consultants by government departments for their insight, their knowledge and their brilliance. If these people are catastrophic failures, they have been nothing but a life of failure. They're failed professionals, they're incompetent, and they're fools. And yet we're still shoved in their faces, told, this is a guy who knows what he's talking about, what his advice is what we need to know. And people watch this stuff on TV, and they never think, or they're never told, that this individual may have 30 years of gross incompetence in terms of economic advice. Why are these people still on our televisions? Why are these fools still in our newspapers? Why are these incompetent catastrophes still being hired by government departments to run boards and operations? There really was a Celtic tiger, if you look at it, from a historical aspect. It was in the late 90s, right before the introduction of the euro, when Ireland was able to float our own exchange rates, make our own balance of payments, and set our own exchange rates in regards to our currency, the pund. Interest rates were also under our own control. This was all lost during the introduction of the euro, and in fact the economy actually decreased in terms of its growth during the introduction of the early euro years. It was just a glut of cheap money and lots of credit. The real economic growth, the real Celtic tiger, happened in the late 1990s when we had our own economy and we were not run by the European Central Bank. We had our own currency and we had our own country. This is why a return to the pund would be the first great step towards economic recovery, to disband and remove ourselves from the failed European euro project and return back to our own currency, set our own interest rates, exchange rates and balance of payments. Ultimately, we deserve a better society than what Blake called sorrowful drudgery. If you look at, you know, the Gnostics, they talk about themselves as children of knowledge of the heart. The Gnostics believed that man was trapped in a nightmare until he gained gnosis. Well, the Irish are trapped in a nightmare until we gain our own gnosis. And that own gnosis is realized that we're on the wrong path and we're in the wrong club. If we can figure that out, then Ireland is most certainly a land on the cusp of gnosis. Our own self-awareness to be grasped as discarding our recent past to begin again. A sort of a national experience of our own identity as a people and not economic units, a sort of a interiorization of the Irish self, not servitude to the hocus pocus of globalist financial data and other ephemeral delusions. We do deserve better. This is a human rights issue that extends across all humanity, not Ireland, not just Ireland alone. But the fact is that we have to start behaving like human beings and stop allowing ourselves to be subjected to or subjected upon as human resources.
same thing with cheap credit. You would go down to the AIB, Bank of Ireland, I don't know what you'd name, but an Irish bank. Go to any Irish bank 6, 7, 8 years ago, and you'd say, I need a loan to buy a house. And the bank manager would say, do you want something extra? You'd throw in a car loan. And then people were getting extra things to go to Disneyland or to go on holidays or to go on cruises. Again, they engage with the banking system not out of a sense of need to provide a home, but a sense of desire. And this, I always thought that film was a tremendous allegory for that thinking, that box. The box is opened by desire. And when you enter into the monetary system in terms of things like credit, big bank loans, you have entered into a game, a labyrinth. You've entered into their domain, and suddenly you're on their chessboard. You are poor. It doesn't matter, you know, what your financial status is, if you're working class, middle class, or rich. It does not matter. You've entered into the same game. You're not the chess master. On one side you have the bankers, and on the other side you have the politicians. And they're the ones playing the chess. And no matter who you vote for, how you protest about it, you are still a pawn on the chessboard. The only way to win that game is not to wait for the hope that your side puts the other side in check. The way to win that is to get off the chessboard. People have to start getting off the chessboard. You see, you know, like all the work I put into psychopathology, one thing I've learned about psychopaths, and I'm not saying all bankers are psychopaths, I'm not saying all politicians are psychopaths. What I'm saying is the system itself becomes psychopathic. Becomes pathological, right? So what happens is they're almost like robotic automatons operating a system based on a psychopathic drive. So it's literally an affection. We're literally dealing with a kind of an affection. And Ireland during the Celtic Tiger years became infected. It became infected by this pathogen of desire. Right, and it wasn't just the people, because the people are at the bottom end of the chain. It begins with the ruling classes, to use a kind of a crude socialist kind of analogy, all the way down to, you know, even the poorest people. But the pathogen infects, it infects true society. Now, you'll be amazed how, once you decouple from the system a small amount, something as basic as not watching TV anymore, just a small decoupling, you realize that that's almost, in a modern age, a revolutionary act. It's much more of a revolutionary act in 2013 to stop watching television than to start going down government buildings and throwing petrol guns. Because we don't live in the Paris Commune anymore. Our oppression is the television, is the media, is the government and the bureaucracy. The bureaucracy is in a staggering one. Do not comply. That's a revolutionary act. No. The greatest word in the English language is no. Can you remember, like, during the Lisbon Treaty, fiscal treaty votes, they would have the posters along the road, and it was always on the, you know, on the approach roads to the towns and cities coming in on the end roads, it was always three yes posters and a no poster. And it was like, yes, yes, yes. So like a sexual orgasm, reaching climax. I mean, it was just unbelievable. And then, oh. So it was like, it was a spell, it was a mind control spell to get people to associate no with everything that they should be against, and yes with everything they need, even though every single promise that was made in those yes posters has been completely and totally, you know, retracted, or we never made that promise to begin with. People have very short attention spans these days because of the media. Switching off the television is the ultimate revolutionary act at the beginning, because then you have time to think, then you have time to find solutions. It's the same thing is when you're in a very toxic relationship. It's like a trial separation. It just gives you time to think. And that would be that's an enormous one, because that's all propaganda, everything. Even how the news is put on. You know, in my last book, The Anvil of the Psyche, I spoke a lot about how news is used to medicate us. You get a fix of, you know, adrenaline. Oh, what am I going to be rescued from today? And at the very end, the sports or the public sort of happy story. And you get your little dopamine fix. And you're medicated at regular intervals. 1 p.m, 6 p.m, 9 p.m. Wherever country, but it's around those times. Three fixes of dopamine a day. And that's exactly how they control us, get rid of that thing. You know, it's just the same thing as in Catholicism. We have the Angelus. You know, the bell rings at 6 o'clock. That's to remind you that you're going to be saved.
the salvation. We don't mean fix. And in Ireland, we still have the angel. In a predominantly country that's predominantly not religious anymore, we're still given the angelus at 6 p.m. before the 6 p.m. news. It's the same thing. It's the same thing. So get rid of that. You're programmed totally through the TV. It's robbing you of time you need in your life for everything. People put their emotions into things like foreign soccer teams and stuff like that. No, they're foreign corporations. Having an emotional relationship with Manchester United or Liverpool is the same thing as having an emotional relationship with a record company or a corporation, Coca-Cola. It's the same thing. People have to stop this. They have to start getting their lives together that way. There is a lot of hope for the future. It's not a bleak vista by any count. Now, people in the past have faced things that were pretty bad in their own way. In this country, we've had famines, we had the penal laws, we've had mass emigration, we've had oppression by the Catholic Church and by the foreign administration and the domestic administration. We had the troubles up north, but you know, we're still here. We're still here, and that tells you that, you know, the human resolve, no matter what, not just in Ireland, in any country, human beings have a tremendous ability to adapt. And this is what we'll... That's the psychopaths. I don't like saying the psychopaths in power because they're not all psychopaths, but they're they're infected with a psychopathic culture. They don't have creativity and they don't have wisdom, and we have to get that cynicism back. I'm a firm believer in things like satire and taking the piss out of politicians and making fun of them. And you know, the jester was the one in court who died of old age, while all the rest were all killed in assassinations. But the one who lived was the jester. Because he could mock the king and survive. And when you put the deck of cards back in the pack, the joker is always on the top, so the joker trumps all the court cards. And that's a powerful, you know, allegory. So that's why, you know, we Irish people, we have a tremendous ability to take the piss out of others.
Major issue is the civil service in Ireland. These are basically, at this point, thanks to things like partnership and the Good Friday Agreement, the civil service and the trade unions, the public sector trade unions, that is, have been bought off, pampered, and turned into a kind of Orwellian inner party. And they act as a buffer between the citizenry and the government. The government overindulges and pampers the unions and the civil service, knowing that they will become almost like fanatical Rottweilers of the government system. You can spot a lot of these types on various message boards. Any message board in Ireland, or even many of the comment sections of online newspapers, you can spot the civil servants a mile away, the ones that are being paid to, you know, defend public policy, defend government, defend new draconian taxes. It's always based on the same idea. They attack people, never attack the idea. And they always say things like, well, it could be much worse, you could be living in Africa or Russia or something like that. This is something people should not put up or tolerate. Comparing Ireland to countries where people have a lower standard of living is a way of saying, you know, you deserve to be poorer. Because ultimately, what the term austerity means is poverty. Again, a change of the terms of reference. And Charles Haughey was kind of for my generation, he was not so much a devil or anything like that, but he represented things that were just wrong. His reign in government was disastrous. He achieved nothing. He portrayed himself as almost like a man of the people. He lived in a palace. When he called future Taoiseach, now past Taoiseach, the man who oversaw the destruction of the Irish nation, Bertie Ahern, Charles Haughey called him the most cunning and devious of them all. He wasn't criticizing him. He was actually praising him. We have to stop putting these pathological individuals into government and spotting them for what they are. A man of the people is never a man of the people. A professional champion is never a champion of the citizens. When they try to act, behave, and look like one of us, what they're really doing is they're mimicking one of us. And why they're mimicking one of us is because they want to dupe, manipulate, pull a fast one, and then laugh at us. Don't let them laugh at you anymore. You deserve better than this.
Well, I see one of the things with the control system is that they constantly want us to dehumanize people we perceive as our enemies. So they're always finding enemies for us. We have, like I said, we have to see people who may be in the police or army as they're not our enemies. They're us in a different form. They're working for us, and we have to have compassion for them. And we should not see them as enemies, because that's diverting the attention away from the problem and towards a distractive force, which has nothing to do with it. Brendan Behan, when he wrote the play The Hostage, even though Brendan Behan was a lifelong IRA, member, and even served time in prison in England for trying to blow up a shipyard in Liverpool, Brendan Behan's most famous play, The Hostage, was about a British soldier who had been captured and was being held prisoner by the IRA inside a brothel in Dublin during the War of Independence. Brendan Behan could have easily dehumanized the British soldier within this brothel who was the hostage, but his sympathies, even though he was an IRA, even though he had been active in the war against Britain, his sympathy was towards the British working class soldier who was held inside as the hostage. And it's a great, that's a great understanding we need to have. Do not dehumanize these people. They're still human beings like the rest of us. Unless, of course, they're psychopaths. That's a different thing altogether. But most people we'll be dealing with in terms of, the vast majority of them, in terms of, who represent the withdrawal system, would be people just like the rest of us who found themselves on a different position on the chessboard. It would be completely wrong to dehumanize these people. It's much better to win them over and bring them around to our side, rather than to pushing them back, because when you start attacking them, all human nature will dictate that all they will want to do then is defend their position even harder. So you win more friends with honey than you will with shit. That's the way we should approach this stuff too. The Swiss, right? The Swiss have built a culture on perfect timekeeping, and yet their national hobby is suicide. There's a lot to be said for being healthy dysfunctional, because you're outside the system and you're less likely to be on Prozac, antidepressants and other drugs, because you're not being subject to an artificial time structure. And that's another way of getting out of it as well. People have to remember this, that again, when you go through this process of what they call waking up, that everything is now open for play. And that includes things about how you even live. What time you get up in the morning, what time you eat, and what time you go to sleep. These things are dictated to us in an artificial measurement. We have to stop that. That's just drive them mad. We can drive them mad by non-cooperation. We can drive them mad. We can play the same games on them that they play on us. We learn to use their tools against us. They're constantly filling us with contradictory information. 1 year coffee is great for you, the next year coffee is good for you. 5 years ago, spend, now austerity. They're constantly giving you mixed messages. It makes you confused. It makes you, when you're confused, you're more likely to turn to experts, because you no longer believe that you can actually control yourself. We can take that back on them. We can actually, confuse them. There's a lot of that happening with some of the freemen guys who are actually going into the courts and challenging the courts through the court structure. This is something they're very good at. What they're doing is they're befuddling the judges and the lawyers with basically a kind of a brilliant word salad, using their own legalese gobbledygook against them. And that's a really good way to, that's a good way to, we should be doing everything. So, that's the ultimate revolutionary act, is not to actually play, but actually fight back through, like I said, satire. But also, we Irish have an ability to be a pain in the ass. And that's good. That's a good thing. It's good to be a pain in the ass.
Because when you're not a pain in the ass, that means you're a slave. When you start being a pain in the ass, that's when you stop being a slave. So many products that they are built with, like, you know, those Terminator chips in them, that they're actually planned obsolescence in them. And like you were saying about, like, you could have a machine where one part of the machine, like a sprocket or, you know, a cam spring, that's gone. Doesn't matter how complex the machine is, its whole functionality is dead. Well, we have to be like Terminator chips within the control system. So that's really what it is. You, me, other people who have had enough of this system and how it behaves, we have to become, one by one, each one of us, a Terminator chip within the control structure. And that's not that difficult, because things will spread from person to person. See, I'm a great believer in example. You know, you live your life by example. If you see someone who's miserable, and he's like working the 9-to-5 thing, paying his taxes, doing everything the tax man tells him, doing everything the government tells him, everything the telly man tells him, and you see he's miserable, and you see someone who's dropped out of the system, he's probably running a small business, you know, he's doing bartering, and he and his kids look much happier. Well, that's going to affect people. So that's why, you know, unfortunately, we're in the alternative movement, there's a lot of this kind of negativity, like, oh, you know, fear, you know, that's not going to win you any friends. You must be look positive, and you must look like a winner, you know. You must look like a winner. You must project the image of someone who's confident, you know, because really what we're selling here is a new form, a new way of living, a new design for living. And the way to do that is to show that you're actually happy and not hiding behind, oh, it's the protocols of Zion, oh, it's this, that. That's not going to work. You're just going to become an isolated nutcase. You know, it doesn't matter what happens in other countries in terms of your own community. But if you're among your people in your community, and they see you, and they see how much more relaxed you are and how much better your lifestyle is, and you actually project an element of quality of life, that's very intoxicating to other people. And then they say to themselves, well, why is that guy down the road so happy? And they'll say, well, because he's, you know, he's not a slave to the system. There's a lot to be said for that, to being our own salesman, you know. So again, it don't be, you know, they say this new age thing, oh, it's, you know, be positive. It's not like that at all. That's not about, you don't project positive. You project confidence. Confidence and self. A sense of self in terms of, like, this is who I am. I know I'm not perfect. I'll probably never be perfect. But right now, I've found the groove that's fine for me. And that's, you'll be amazed how much that impresses other people. Particularly people that don't think about things beyond what a television tells them. It can be like a trigger. You know, we've all had in our waking up things, some kind of trigger. And you can trigger other people by, you know, religious groups have done this for the wrong ways over the years. They will have that sort of the church happy kind of smile, you know. But that even works on people because they think they're happy and I'm not. The scene in The Simpsons where they see the happy family, it's just a projection of happiness, it's not real. It's like one of Ned Flanders' kids says, when we were with Mrs. Simpson, we had real happy, not church happy. And you see, that's a real message there. You have to be real happy, and not new age or church happy. And then say, this is me, this is what I am. And if you don't like it, well, okay, you don't like it. I don't have to live. I didn't manifest a born or, you know, the sperm and the egg didn't gestate in order for me to live up to your expectations of me. This is my personal experience within this world. And the ones I love are part of it too as well. And if you don't like that, once I'm not harming anybody, once it's people consenting among themselves, it's none of your business. See, that's another reason why they make success with celebrities. That's another thing too with the politicians. I've noticed that the newspapers, if any kind of politician has some kind of titillation, like he's, you know, he's banging his secretary, or, you know, he's seen with somebody, or he's getting a divorce, or he's, you know, they love putting that on the front of the pages. Have you noticed that? But if they do anything in terms of, like, policy that may destroy the country, that's never there. So they've trained us to be obsessed with people's personal lives. And that titillation is also, a distraction. And that's why, you know, you go into you see these magazines and they're just all over the shops and they're all about the personal lives of celebrities. That's completely, again, carrying other people's problems. That's not your problem.
It's nothing to do with you. It's nothing to concern yourself with. Because they don't want you thinking about yourself, on yourself, and who you are. See, the last... You see, not only have they trained people not to really look at ourselves, but they've also made it the most difficult thing in the world. And they put everything from psychiatry to psychiatric medications to all kinds of life coaches and spiritual and gurus and all kinds of, you know, leaders in between and all kinds of mentors. So we do not look at ourselves as the most, still the most terrifying thing for a person to do is look at themselves. And if people look at themselves, honestly, 99 times out of 100, they'll like what they see. So that's another reason they tell us to look at ourselves, because we'll actually see attributes in ourselves that they haven't put into us. For the first time in history, right, thanks to the internet, right, humanity now has not only the jigsaw piece is in the box, but we now have the box cover. We have the illustration on the box. So now we know exactly what we're to start building towards. And for the first time ever, individuals are now able to actually put their own pieces to their next friend, to the next friend, to the next piece. And we're starting to build that image on the box. It's tremendously exciting. We're finally moving towards solving the puzzle, solving the jigsaw puzzle. That's a really, you know, we're a blessed generation. We're a blessed people, you know, right now, because our parents and grandparents didn't have this. They had the mainstream media, and there was no alternative media. There was no way they could actually go onto the internet and have a discussion with someone in Australia or South Africa and realize that these people had the same issues you did, you know. And what's happening is they're all pulling our little piece of the jigsaw picture together. It's a very exciting time to be alive. We're actually solving the puzzle, and even though you may not see it in your life, you know that you're part of that solution, because there's no utopia, there's never, I always say an idealist is a nice way of saying a fascist, because what they're doing is projecting their failures on others or on systems, you know. So idealism is like fascism with a nice name. Nothing is perfect, nothing is absolutely wonderful, nothing is a utopia. But it's the challenge of getting there. I can always remember, like, when I was in a band, the most exciting part was not necessarily completing a song, but when a bunch of us would come together and something would happen along the way. It was the process of creation rather than the finished project. And that was the actual magic, where the best feeling was in that moment. And we're actually, as a generation, as a people, no matter what class we are, the ones who we say are woken up or waking up or whatever, we are so blessed that we're part of a very exciting development in human beings, where we're finally getting the pieces of the jigsaw that our ancestors gave it to us, putting it together. So it's a magical moment when we think about it. And we should never take that for granted. You know, people talk about, you know, well, what's the solution? And you have people say, well, it's time for revolution. Well, you look at the word revolution, what does revolution mean? To come right back where you started. And there are elements within this society who are actually using political agitators to try and start riots so they can implement more social controls, particularly in terms of security and, you know, clampdowns. So instead of having a revolution, what we really need is evolution. What we need are people who actually have to move beyond the system. You know, it's one thing to say, okay, we get out of debt, our problems are solved. Well, no, they're not. That's like saying, you know, getting a divorce, you know, solves all your relationship problems. No, you still want another relationship. It's still time to have a new relationship again. Same thing with getting out of debt. It's only the beginning, but also it's not that easy to get out of debt. But there's things you can do in between. When I'm talking to people about dealing with a psychopath, say someone at work or something, my attitude is the only way to deal with them is no contact ever again. Just get them out of your life, get away from them, and have nothing to do with them ever again. You will never reform them. You will never meet them 50% along the way. It'll never be a one-on-one, you know, dialogue. You'll always be a host to a parasite. And the same attitude towards the system. Non-compliance. Do not comply.
one thing you can do is that if you still want to elect people and it comes around election time, vote only for independents and make any kind of cushy arrangement in government between parties impossible, because the whole system will be flooded with independents. In fact, I would even encourage people to vote for the most crackpot independents once they're not racist or psychopaths. Vote them in. Cause chaos. Smash up the cushy system by making the old system and the old cushiness impossible to continue. Our government is basically a kind of a monarchy. You'll find that the same parties have been in power for years, and the sons and daughters of the present members of government, if we don't stop this, will be in government in, you know, years to come, just like their fathers and mothers and their grandparents and and uncles have all been in government. This is a kind of a monarchy. It's almost like a bloodline system within Irish politics. That has to be smashed up. The best way to do that is to vote for non-aligned independence. Another thing that gives me a lot of hope is that the children of all the immigrants that have flooded this country in the last 20 years or so will have a major effect. The reason is they will be quite different than previous generations of Irish people, in that they'll have a sort of a multicultural approach. They won't be bought off as easy with, you know, things like the GAA and, you know, parish pumps and stuff like that, because they'll have, you know, one side of them will be Polish, or, you know, from the Middle East, or from India, from Eastern Europe, from Russia. These people are going to have a very different mindset. These will not be interested in the same old system of politics. They're not going to vote for some, you know, local politician because their dad or their grandparents voted for them, because they won't have that. So a real asset we have in this country is the children of immigrants. When they come of age, will be very, very different than the complacent voters that we have now. This should provide us with a whole opportunity for any kind of alternative movement to tap into. Another aspect of non-compliance is to get off the grid. Get off as much as possible, pay as little to utilities as you can. And especially, this is an important one for people who live in rural communities or in small towns, is deal in cash as much as you can. When you have cash in your pocket, you're forced to spend local. You're forced to spend in your local businesses where you have, you know, debit cards or credit cards, and that's your main means of purchasing. It makes you, you know, purchase on the internet. That money is then robbed out of your community. If you have cash and you deal in cash, that money is spent locally. Barter and other forms of trade, different tradespeople, would be a great way forward. More importantly, we have to start thinking about what it means to be an Irish person. What does being an Irish person mean? Does it mean being a tax slave? Are we just animals on a tax farm for the IMF? Livestock to be exploited? Or do we have a meaning or a purpose as a people? This is something that I think we will recapture in time, as we see, as the present generation diminishes. There is hope for the future. It's not hopeless. Remember, we have to be like a phoenix and rise from the ashes, and we can do it. We've done it before. We are a people that are capable of reinventing ourselves and rejuvenating ourselves. But that must begin with a new understanding of ourselves.
Even in ancient Greece, you had both sides of the argument, right up until the modern era. Given two sides of the philosophical coin, one in favour of and one against. Ever since World War II, in particular, the media is no longer, the mainstream media, is no longer an unobjective commentator, a pundit, throwing out ideas for the masses to consider. The media, particularly news media, and very especially in Ireland, the mainstream media in Ireland is nothing other than the government press office. That's all it is. It's nothing else. Okay? There is no intermediary in the true sense. There's no true media in the middle that jumps in there and says, well, this is what the government is doing, and this is what they're trying to say, or this is what they're saying, and they're not doing. It's purely a verbatim regurgitation of the government press office press release. The media has completely failed. So therefore, you have people that sit at home and they say, well, have you heard about the household tax? And one will give one side of the story and one will give the other. But both sides are the state-sanctioned side. But also there's an element of self-responsibility there. Well, you say, well, okay, it's their own fault. But people are trained not to think that way. They're trained to be impulsive rather than impulsive and reactive rather than wisdom. There's no natural thinking in terms of dealing with things down the road. It's purely what the social sort of like paradigm dictates. My sister got a big house, the fellow next door got a big house, I have to get one. It doesn't mean that it's not keeping up with the Joneses in a crass way. It's absolutely brainwashing. It's absolutely a peer pressure thing, right? But there's an element of desire. Human beings, they the allegory of the forbidden fruit in the book of Genesis is true. I mean, that's what human beings are. Is it, you know, back in the 1980s, Clive Barker made the movie Hellraiser. It was based around a box. And the box, when you opened the box, it gave you unlimited pleasures. Okay? Sexual pleasure. But the unlimited sexual pleasure was a doorway to these things called the Cenobites, who were a sadomasochistic group of demons who just like tore you to sunder eventually. They fed on your energy. Well, the box that they had in the film Hellraiser, it was opened by desire. It wasn't opened by curiosity. In the same way, when people were given cheap credit, they didn't use their gold cards to buy food, the gold cards to buy things they didn't need. Rolex watches, all kinds of gadgets. So the impetus was the desire, not the necessity.
So people ask me, you know, what is the solution here? What's the answer? Well, the fact is that we're dead, okay? There's an element of debt regarding this nation. We're gone. The Republic of Collins, Pierce, and even De Valera is dead. That does not exist anymore. We are an EU vassal, IMF vassal state. There's nowhere to go except up. People at the moment in 2013 are not really feeling it hard at the moment yet, but they will. They're being bought off by, you know, English and British soccer, you know, the whole bread and circuses thing. But that'll only last for so long. It will only, you know, last for so long. This is why Irish politicians want the Irish soccer team or the Irish rugby team or some athlete in the Olympics to do well, because it takes the heat off them. It distracts the plebs. One of the things I would say to people is do not riot. Do not riot at all, because this is what they want. Not just in Ireland, but in any country where you're sick and tired of the system. Do not riot. There are many Marxist organizations which pretend to represent, you know, working people, which are actually fronts and setups designed to cause trouble. They're being paid to implement riots and implement more controls and bring down the name and the reputation of any kind of counter-government movement. But that doesn't mean you should be complacent. That doesn't mean you should acquiesce. We must be rude to our government. I've always been a strong believer in non-compliance, non-cooperation. Mahatma Gandhi and Nehru, they freed India simply by taking the British Empire out of the equation through non-compliance and through self-sufficiency. And this is one thing we can do. We have to be very clever about this. You look at the civil rights movement, the African-American civil rights movement in the USA in the 1960s, very clever. They bust in people from other states and other cities to, say, places like Selma, Mississippi, in order to swell the numbers so the local police force couldn't deal with the sheer number of African Americans who were there protesting. There are lessons to be learned in these very clever tactics. Martin Luther King and Gandhi showed us the way to do this. You do not cooperate with the present system. That doesn't mean you start throwing petrol bombs and attacking the police.
If I have one talent in this life, it's I have an ability to see things as they really are, not how they're told they are, and then I have an ability to, in plain language, to explain it to people. I think if I have one gift in life, that's it. That's it. And, you know, and I'm fortunate that I was able to contribute to that at that time to these people, to the world in general, anyone who read these books or saw the videos. And that was my puzzle piece. That's what the book was called, Puzzling Pieces, because the puzzle, it was coming. And I think we're all hitting that now. We're all hitting it. And we're all getting those pieces. And we have the picture on the box. And the picture on the box is a dysfunctional, pathological system that's been engineered by some psychopaths, that's turned decent people into proto-psychopaths, and it's not working anymore. And literally, that's what we're... We now have the ability to solve that problem. We don't have to bring it down to race, religion, class. We don't have to deal with the old problems of, you know, revolution and, you know, dealing with the political system. We're looking at something very clearly now. It's come into focus, and it's really where we're going. I really do believe this is an evolutionary thing. I don't mean that in any kind of hippy-trippy new way. I literally mean in actual biological, social, you know, every other way, economic even. We're evolving. And we're evolving now because we have the roadmap. That's the picture on the box is. It's the roadmap to salvation. And the roadmap to salvation is understanding what the problem is. Just like when someone's an alcoholic or someone's a drug addict, until they sit down and say, I'm an alcoholic or I'm a drug addict, that's the point that they start recovery. Same thing with the society. I started off when, you know, I said earlier on, we're in a dysfunctional relationship with culture. We're in a dysfunctional relationship with our society. Okay? It's not working. It's not happening. We're divorcing from it. It's divorcing from us. Rather than to fall apart, let's just be adults about it, have a mature conversation. Let's split. Anybody. No bloodshed. And I really do believe that. That's true maturity. And if we can do that as a people, as a society, as an individuals, my God, that would be the greatest revolutionary act in history, because we did it without having to sink down to their levels.
That's Ireland today. Nobody wants to talk about this underlying feeling that so many people have. So many Irish people know there's something profoundly wrong with this society. There's something intrinsically wrong and pathological to the point of evil that we're being forced to pay 52% of the total euro debt, where Germany, with 8 times the population, pays 1.5%. There is no justification given for this. We're never told why, but yet Irish people walk around saying, well, what can you do? Or we should leave it to the experts. The reality is there is no relationship expert that can heal a broken relationship. And there's no economic expert that can heal a broken economic relationship. There is only one solution to this, and that's a mature adult dialogue between the citizenry and the administrative cultures, whatever you want to call them, government, bankers, business. We're not getting that from the media. What we're getting from the media is government press releases. Government press releases do not tell you the truth. They're designed to create distraction. When you see something before your eyes, you know that's real. When you see this hand in front of my face, you know that's real. I know I have five fingers. A government press release in Ireland in 2013, and has been for a long time, has been telling us we have six fingers. They're gaslighting us. What gaslighting means is presenting you with false information, creating a false reality, and from this, developing a false notion of yourself. Irish people do not know who they are right now. There's a disconnect from what we are. We've lost so much. We've lost so much in terms of our national identity. We lost it from the 80s going on. Now, there was things we had to change, and there was things we had to improve in terms of things like civil rights for gay people, single mothers, divorced people, and so on. These were all good things. But along the way, we sacrificed our culture. We sacrificed what we are as a people. You look behind me here, the mountains of Connemara. These mountains have survived wars, famines, mass emigration, and yet they're still there. These cultures remained all the way up until the 1980s. Something happened in the 1980s where our culture began to be eradicated. You ask an Irish person today, what does it mean being Irish? And I can tell you, they just don't know. And the reason they just don't know is because they're no longer connected to the society.